this ordinance from the book of Mark, chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. And he was on the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe, and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey?" Has anyone
heard? There's been a huge debate in the news lately, and I'm sure you've seen it, and it's been about climate change and ecological concerns, and it's between a difference of opinion, of qualifications to speak authoritatively about the subject. On one side, we have the Pope, and the other side, a prominent presidential candidate, which I won't name, but they don't agree who should be taking center stage in leading this vital conversation. The presidential candidate doesn't believe that the Pope should be taking a stand on climate change. "That's not what you do," he says. "It's not your place. Let's leave that to the scientists, Pope." Well, in all actuality, the Pope is a scientist. Pope Francis holds a degree as a chemical technician and worked as a chemist before turning to the priesthood, actually. And it just goes to show that we should do our homework before we speak. The Pope recently released a 192-page encyclical paper. It's a document that he issued to the bishops, and it's about climate change and ecology. It's good timing that we talk about that, especially with, you notice in our country, all of the, you know, tornadoes and the 24 inches of rain and all the different storms that we haven't seen before. Seems to be happening around the world in different countries. So this is a very important topic. But speaking of storms and unusual storms, we find in the reading today, Jesus traveling in a boat, and what is he doing? He's sleeping on a cushion. And all of a sudden, this terrible storm is brewing, and the boat's tossing back and forth among the turmoil. A feeling of chaos is what the people feel. Chaos all around. And even having Jesus in the boat with them, sleeping on a cushion, with that safety net, that, what do you call it, lifesaver, with them in the boat with them, they were overcome with fear. In both scenarios, the climate change issue and the storm in which the disciples traveled, God didn't necessarily create the storm, but God can be found in the middle of the storm and can be the answer to the turmoil. Right, Bishop? But why do we as people turn to God either after it's too late for a healthy resolution, or we wait so long in the journey that we see God in a time of desperation? Do we live as though God is fast asleep on a cushion, living as we ourselves are the source? We are the safety net. We're the navigators of our own destinies and not God. Why do we require is the key word, tragedies in our own lives, not to wake up God, but to wake up ourselves, to open up our spirit to the needs of those around us. Brothers and sisters, we're in the middle of a horrendous storm. It is a storm. I can feel it. You can feel it. A torrential storm landed last Wednesday on the town of Charleston, South Carolina. A young man named Dylan Storm Roof well, African Methodist Episcopal Church's Wednesday evening Bible study. He walked into the house of God to study the Word of God with people of God. And before it's over, he kills 9 people in attendance. One lady, we heard, actually threw herself on top of her child and pretended to be dead in order to save her own child. And out of these 9 people who died horrifically, one was the pastor named Clementa Pinckney, 41 years old, who's married with 10 children and has served in the state senate for South Carolina since the year 2000, and he's been the youngest person to do so in that state's history, 41 years old. It tells you what an incredible person he was. Pastor Pinckney was a dad, a father, a leader, a pastor, a mentor, an educator, but most importantly, a brother in Christ. Horrific storms had landed before at this historic Emmanuel AME church. They have history. That church offered courageous slave rebellions, that church did. That church suffered and survived rich and bigotry, burnings, and even an earthquake. That church had to worship underground when black churches were outlawed. Yet they overcame. They weathered torrential storms, and humanity has brought forth another storm in their path and in their journey. But how will what happened in Charleston, how many days ago, how will that change us? How soon will this horrific act and this tragedy leave our consciousness, and how soon will our intense rage become a distant memory of a faded time where we were disappointed in humanity? Remember in April of 2014, 200 Nigerian girls, 16 and 17 years old, were kidnapped, were taken. They haven't been recovered. And do we even talk about that today? If they were white girls in this country, we wouldn't be talking about that today. If they were, they would be home. I believe that. The people of Charleston, they can relate to today's lectionary reading. And like Stephen said in the beginning, not only was that song, "You'll Never Walk Alone," we aren't alone. They, the people of Charleston, aren't alone. We know there'll be joy in the morning. But the disciples there of Christ, our brothers and sisters, are caught in a storm. They have felt, you see, that rope rocked back and forth, and wondering if it was going to tip over at any minute. This week they've experienced the torrential wind of evil. They've experienced yet again the grip of oppression. Last Wednesday night their boat traveled down the darkness of a swell, and the power of a giant wave overcame them, and all they could feel was darkness. But in watching the news, within 24 hours of this mass murder, what makes me sad the most is, within 24 hours, it becomes a debate about gun control. It becomes a debate over the issue of the Confederate flag. It becomes, was this really, some people have the nerve to say, was this really an act of racism? And all these things are very important. And good will come out of this, I know, because my God will, good will come out of this. But right now, today's Father's Day, there are children and grandchildren suffering over the loss of their father, the loss of their granddad, and family members. One family member's response was, "Every fiber in my being hurts. I'm not a dad. I can't even imagine." Imagine the impact this is having on the church where that occurred. What if it happened in our church and affected it? Imagine the effect on the neighborhood and the people who witnessed the emergency vehicles pulling up. And I've known people who run went what they call body removal services. Think of the people that went to remove the bodies from that church. What they witnessed. What they saw that day. They will be changed forever. So much of the impact and focus is already on political debate, yet nine people died. In the Pope's 192-page paper, I read it. It's an inspired document. I might not agree with all of his views, and I don't, but I agree with this. The Pope says, in the first creation account in the book of Genesis, God's plan includes creating humanity. After the creation of man and woman, God saw everything that God had made, and behold, it was very good. The Bible teaches that every man and every woman is created out of love and made in God's image and in God's likeness, the Pope says. This shows us the immense dignity of every person. Every person is not just something, but someone. She and he is capable of self-knowledge, of self-possession, and of freely giving him or herself to enter into agreement with other people. The Creator can say to each one of us, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. We were conceived in the heart, the very heart of God. And for this reason, each of us is the result of the thought of God. Each one of us is a result of the thought of God. Each of us is willed. Each of us is loved. Each of us is necessary. Yet the evil of racism, which has faded in the last few decades, has made itself visible again. And when I was praying about it, I thought, was it the fear that it was losing power in the last few months? Was it the fear that racism was losing power, that it felt the need to make itself visible again to us? We know it existed, but now it wants to be visible to us instead of afraid. Ours, yours, and my Christian brother died in that church this past Tuesday. It wasn't somebody in another city, in another state. That was a brother and sister in Christ with each one of us. That was one of our family members. It makes me think of it in a different way. How would we honor the deaths of six sisters? Imagine in your family, we used to have families that had 15, 20 people, something like that. What happened if six sisters and three brothers died in one day from a horrendous, useless act of violence like that? There were our brothers and sisters who were part of the Christian church, our church, our family, God's church, doing work, and they were actively combating racism, work that our church needs to do and partner in. They were doing God's work in our behalf. In our behalf. The work of liberating a captive and freeing a prisoner, not just metaphorically and praying about it, but literally in their government. How will we partner with them in the future, I ask myself? We're all passionate today. We're all filled with rage and anger and just feel like in a state of wonder, don't we? We can't believe and shock. But how will we partner with them in the future? In Christ, their blood kin. That's what our faith teaches. How will we respond to race-based killing of our blood kin? A few Sundays ago, one of our readings was Matthew chapter 12, verses 48 through 50. Jesus replied to him, "Who is my mother and who are my brothers?" Pointing to his disciples, saying, "Here are my mother and here are my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and my sister and my mother." How will we respond to the culture that shaped the murderer to hate in such a way? How will we respond to what was called his hate that we say was part of his culture, the group he hung around with, and the people that knew him, and he talked to them about causing this, yet they didn't feel the need to react about it. The killer had shared his talk with friends and others. But in the reading today, Mark reveals that there were other notes also on the scene with him in this story. And when I was reading that text again this week, I said, I never remember seeing that part. It was just that one boat that Jesus was in with the disciples, and he was sleeping on the cushion. But no, there were other boats. Did you hear Suzanne say that? Other boats. And it's a different story. And in writing this sermon, I thought, what were those other boats about? What were the other boats doing? Why were they there? They were following Jesus. But the other boats, this one, the boat we read about today, the boat we know from hearing that story over and over, we know it's about Peter. But I believe those other boats were filled with oppression. They were filled with judgment. They were filled with homophobia. They were filled with prejudice. And they were filled with hate. These evils are very much alive. Earlier this month, the body of a 17-year-old, in June of 2015, about 2 weeks ago, in Alabama, I used to work in the panhandles in Alabama all the time, back and forth, but the body, a lifeless body of a 17-year-old transgender woman was discovered. She had been murdered and they found her grave. And next week, the decision regarding the Supreme Court case for marriage equality is going to be announced. And the response to that, there are pastors, Christian pastors, threatening, if that passes, if justice happens, I'm going to set myself on fire. Yes, it's time to wake Jesus up, because we're caught in the midst of a storm. Right in the midst of multiple storms, and we're not taking responsibility for our parts in them. Jesus, we beckon you, one who calms the sea, to wake up and save us not from the storms, but from ourselves. In the midst of that swell, which we again engulf, you're the light, God, we may walk towards. You're the light that we must see. You, O Lord, are the one who can save us from ourselves and from the depths of the sea. You're the one whom we are called to trust, to believe in, God, to obey. You, mighty God, are the answer to our wounds and our hurts, especially this time. You are the comforter which the world needs, especially today. Glimpses of light were only a glass of milk. Following are some of the responses from the deceased family members. The husband of one of the women shot and killed at that church says, he forgives the man who used to slay his wife. Eight others. Middleton Brown's sister was among the dead. She says her family has no room for hate, and we have to forgive. The sister of one of the women killed inside this church says she's very angry, but that her sister taught her that we are the family that love builds.
Yours are the eyes, you are his body, she says. Christ
has no body now but yours, no hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassion on this world. Christ has no body now on earth but ours. Church, the conversation of what we need to do next, it doesn't start in the church. It starts in this church. We can't overcome merely by sitting in the pew. God, lead us through this storm. That's my prayer this week. Reveal to us